In the month of October 1957, the Soviet Union was successful in placing an Earth satellite into orbit. In so doing, they changed the entire concept of modern warfare. The story you are about to see would be inevitable should the wrong people gain control of that government. The cogs of an intricate federal machine began to revolve. The task of finding out about the intent of this foreign achievement eventually ended up in the office of the Central Intelligence Group.
We believe it was fired from a base in the Caspian Sea area, using their prototype ICBM as the rocket power to put the satellite in its present orbit. We plotted each circuit of the globe to be in a southwest northeast direction and to take 96 minutes. That's about all we know, except that it is broadcasting on two common frequencies and the signal is not coded. What we do not know is whether it is sending out code while over Russia, and if it is, what information it may be given. We think at the moment it may be nothing more than a device for propaganda, but they may have a big jump on us. I'll let Dr. Hemlich explain.
The intercontinental missile program has been held up awaiting some way to get a report on three vital points to do with outer space. One, the exact density of the air at the altitude the missile will travel. Second, the effect of radioactivity on such a rocket. Third, do the other planets exert enough gravitational pull to cause deviation in the navigational equipment? The whole purpose of a world satellite is to find the answers to these questions. The first country to obtain these information will be able to fire a successful missile within 6 months. You may as well answer it, General. That's all I have to say.
Watkins here. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Right away. Yes, sir.
The pencil, please.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
The political pressures regarding this matter were terrific. Consequently, it wasn't long before a top-secret coded message reached the desk of George White, chief of the European Bureau of the Central Intelligence Group.
Thank you very much for your kind cooperation. Yours truly, George White. Would you have that typed up and see that it gets on the courier plane to Washington, please?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Oh, yes, will you send him in? I've been waiting for him. How you doing, John?
Fine. How are you, George?
Good to see you. Sit down.
Thanks.
Oh, what's up? John, I sent for you because you're the best agent we have.
Thanks, George.
What's the job? When you start passing out compliments, I figure there's usually something pretty big up.
Something big is up. Washington has been on my back for weeks to get somebody into Moscow. They want to find out if the Reds are really on the right track with their satellites.
Well, aren't these satellites just a good propaganda move on their part?
We hope so. But they may be getting data that would put them way ahead of us.
Well, what do you want me to do?
You're going to be flown into Russia, then make your way to Moscow. There you'll contact one of our agents. It's all in here. Incidentally, destroy that after you've read it.
Yeah, I will.
The agent is a girl, but we think that she's the right one for the job.
A girl? Well, that sounds interesting.
Remember, John, we want information, not a repetition of that affair in Vienna.
Oh, that was completely different. Seriously, George, when do I go?
Right now. I'll drive you to a little airport outside of town. One of our best pilots will take you in a special civilian plane. And, John, I've no need to tell you, if you're caught, we'll have to say that we never heard of you.
I've been through that before, remember? Is it okay if I stop by my apartment and pick up a toothbrush?
Sure. Let's go.
White drove Manston to a tiny civilian airfield. Here they met the pilot, who was to fly the agent as far into Russia as was practicable. They were using a civilian plane with civilian markings to avoid as much suspicion as possible, and with the slim hope that if caught, they could pretend to be two innocent civilians who had strayed off course. White himself was not happy as the little plane lifted into the air. It is never pleasant to send a personal friend into such danger, but this job had to be done, and the best man had to do it. During the flight, all papers were first memorized, then destroyed, except for the false ones that identified the two men as tourists. It was not possible to proceed all the way to Moscow, the ultimate destination. The range of the little plane was not sufficient. Also, the vicinity of the Russian capital was too heavily guarded for a landing. Therefore, it was necessary to put down soon after crossing the border of the Soviet Union. There was a small vacant pasture, which the pilot had used before. After leaving the plane, Manston could expect no further help until he reached his contact. This meant traveling by the most inconspicuous ways possible, walking when necessary, and keeping constantly on the alert. At this rate, Moscow lay 1 to 5 weeks away. The capital was apparently peaceful and prosperous under its present regime. But attention was growing, and rumors were beginning to spread about the possibility of the military taking over control of the government. The people were not in favor of this, but military minds do not often consider the desires of the layman when making their plans. Once Manston got to the metropolitan area of Moscow, he found it easier to get about, as there were many tourists from the Western European countries in and around the Russian capital. His instructions had been clear. Go to a certain cafe and wait for a chance to make contact with the agent who was to act as his intermediary.
Oh, Did anyone see you?
No, I waited till the porter went upstairs to the floor above. You look different in these clothes.
May I verify your papers? What are your plans?
First, I must find out if you feel the same way now as you did 2 years ago when you contacted our legation in Turkey.
Yes, I do. I haven't changed my mind. My family was killed resisting the Germans. I escaped to Turkey and later married one of your airmen. He was killed in an accident, and that's when I made my decision. I was told to return here, and I would be contacting. But why have they waited so long?
You are being saved for the big one. And this is the big one. Through your contacts, we have to find out if the Reds have gained any advantage through Sputnik. And if so, how much?
Well, I can tell you this much now. They have all the information they want.
How do you know that?
In a way, even your Mr. George White in Germany hasn't learned. Last month, I became the mistress of the Minister of Defense. When the pig gets drunk, he talks.
What a setup.
I don't know exactly what data they've received from the satellite, but I heard him say it was enough for the engineers to complete their missile design. They all seem very elated.
I wouldn't wonder. Look, I'm going to have to get this back to headquarters as quickly as possible. It'll take them a couple of weeks to contact me with further instructions. In the meantime, I think it would be best if I stayed here. Well, that is, if you don't mind.
I don't mind, but in this case, well, I want to help all I can, but when Joseph gets drunk, he comes here. And for your own sake, I don't think you want to overhear some of the things that happen.
Look, in this business, I have to do a lot of things I don't like to do. If you can stand it, so can I. Okay, roommates?
Okay.
Oh, they've received at least some of the data they needed. I'm sure now they're ahead of us. I know the budget cut slowed you down. Good Lord, man, I'm not blaming the aircraft industry. I'm only asking you all to redouble your efforts. All right, as soon as our satellite is up, you'll get the data you need. But in the meantime, Arthur, just guess. And for all our sakes, guess right.
The aircraft industries did respond. Extra shifts were added. New factory space became available. Most important of all, the inventive and manufacturing genius of American industry was turned to the job at hand, to build a successful intercontinental missile. New manufacturing techniques, many of which were still only in the planning stage, were pushed to completion and put into effect. It was now possible for a section or even an entire factory to be completely controlled from one central point. Automation meant that every stage of manufacture could be minutely inspected during every production process. Fantastic standards of accuracy and unbelievable production records became commonplace. With many different models becoming available, it remained for the final testing to indicate which design had sufficient potential to be developed into a production model. Not only did the final model have to be capable of probing deep into space in search of vital scientific data, its military potential was to be such as to discourage enemy attacks on the North American continent and on the millions of American people. As construction reached a peak, so did the tension. Millions upon millions of dollars of the taxpayers' money had been spent without adequate proof that such a project was even feasible. Before an intercontinental missile could be successful, engineers had to solve many new and insoluble problems. One of the most important was the design of the nose cone. So far, no material had been able to withstand the tremendous heat generated by the rocket re-entering the Earth's atmosphere. Costly as it was, the only way to make progress was by testing, testing, and testing still again. As each new design was ready to be proved in actual flight, it was sent to Cape Canaveral. With it went the engineers who designed it, nervously awaiting the few moments that would spell success or failure for their months and years of painstaking work. Failure would have to be retested later. Tremendous cost. A successful flight would add one or two more precious scraps of data to America's steadily growing fund of information about rockets and their behavior.
I got rid of him as fast as I could.
Oh, don't worry about me. I'm okay. You look like you got the worst of it.
Hi, tell me.
Did you find out anything?
Yes, I did, but I'm afraid it's not good. There has been a split in the Presidium. Tomorrow, the military are going to push for a showdown. They want to strike as soon as the missile is finished and while your country is still unable to retaliate.
Well, when will their missile be ready?
I don't know. A lot depends on the vote tomorrow.
It's hard to believe that a group of civilized men could sit around and calmly discuss how to murder 5 or 6 million others.
For the first time, we're ahead of the world. Such a power can do unbelievable things.
Well, it looks like you maybe picked the wrong sign.
I'm happy with my choice.
The marshal has called this meeting to consider the use of Sputnik for military purposes. He now turns to the Minister of Economy and asks his opinion. The minister replies that he doesn't feel that the economy can stand a war at this time, maybe in 10 or 20 years. The marshal replies that time is short, that's impossible. The marshal now asks his staff and the defense minister if they concur with him in this, and they say that they do. However, the other ministers do not agree. The marshal is very annoyed and asks them why it is they feel they can't go along with him in this action. He emphasizes that he has the punch, the advantage of surprise, and the first rockets. The marshal emphasizes that a destroyed New York would give full and absolute control of America to them.
Our agent in Moscow has gotten this information through. There's a new clique assumed power in the Kremlin, the militarists, and they're considering launching a missile as soon as they can. Now, I'll lay my cards on the table. If we can't come up with something better within a reasonable time, this country is going to witness the most frightful disaster it has ever seen. You've got to give me the answer. You've got to give me something.
We've whipped the problem of the skin friction on the warhead. Now that we have our own satellite up, We can modify the navigational equipment. And we're working on a device to protect the rocket from meteorites and radioactivity. Well, give us time. We will give you your missile.
Time? We have no time.
Had we half the money that was appropriated for such worthy projects as cheese price supports, we would have had our ICBM long ago.
I know, but you realize what a peacetime general is up against. But, Eric, at any rate, you now have all the resources of the country behind you.
Yeah.
And God grant that we may not be too late.
Ah, cheers. Ah, George. Ah, George. Thank you. You know, how about the actual... character.
He's asleep. When he's like this, nothing can awaken him.
I wish I knew what was going on inside that brain of his.
Perhaps you will. He's going on an inspection trip to the missile site, and he wants me to go with him.
When?
He leaves on the train in the morning. That's why the celebration tonight. At the slightest excuse, he drinks, and when he's drunk, he wants me. Not for a nice party or dinner, but only here. Why can't he go home to his wife?
Oh, don't think about it. Sometimes when I'm in that closet and he's out here, I'd like to come out here and...
It has to be. I really don't mind.
But I do.
Far to the north lay this fully operational missile base. Standing ready, an intercontinental missile capable of completely destroying a city thousands of miles distant.
Ну ладно, господа. А сейчас наверх пойдем ракету смотреть. А ты, мой друг, пойдешь со мной?
Не могу.
Ну, ты старый. Ну, хорошо, оставь.
Ваной? Иди.
Контрольная комната в порядочно.
Согласна. Все в порядке.
Я очень рад. Здравствуйте. Где же капитан? Скорее, капитан, скорее. Вот ракета.
Да.
Хорошо, вот ты красавица. Я думаю, мы поближе подойдем, да?
Пожалуйста.
Ну и красавица. Какая громадная,
высокая. Вот она.
Согласен,
да,
со мной? Ну, хорошо, это прекрасно.
Да.
Поздравляю вас, господин капитан, с хорошей работой.
Спасибо. Да, поздравляю. Спасибо. Пожалуйста.
Значит, мы готовы.
Все готово. Все в порядке.
Watkins. Oh, hi, dear. No, why don't you go ahead and eat without me? We're testing tomorrow. Oh, I'll be here all night finishing this paperwork. Well, why don't you and Helen take in a movie? Honey, I just have to get these reports out tonight. I know, we've been through all this before. Okay, good night.
Each test flight had its accompanying tensions, but this was the most important flight yet to be scheduled. Several entirely new concepts of missile design were incorporated into this one model. Due to the tremendous pressure being exerted by both military and civilian agencies as a result of the alarming military situation, certain component parts were incorporated into this bird without being exhaustively pre-tested, which up to now was standard operating procedure. Time was running desperately short. The hopes of America and the millions of dollars invested in the missile race up to this point depended upon the successful flight of this one missile. Not only was it important that the satellite be successfully launched into orbit for propaganda and scientific purposes, but at the same time, the rocket itself